Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to my speed painting of the Golden Age Has-Been Hotel crew. What is the Golden Age, you might ask? Great question. It usually spans from the 1930s to the 1940s, sometimes the 1950s. It depends on who is doing the interpretation and whether or not they actually did the research. I talked with my grandma, who actually is from that time period. She was born in 1929 or 8, thereabouts. So this was her time period. And I have all sorts of little items and stuff that she gave me over the years, and sort of got a, using those to sort of get a feel for the period, because that's what I'm going for. I'm trying to make them feel like they're from that time period, not like contemporary, modern day, interpretations of that time period. I wanted to feel like, yes, this, if they were time traveled back into that time period, they'd look a little off because of how wealthy their attire is, but more or less they would see like, oh, this is this feels like that time period, that sort of thing. And let's just go through each one of these one by one and explain what my thought process was. First, we have Nifty on the left here, and she is in a little cocktail dress that's really more of a 50s thing, really, with the shape cut out to show the cleavage right there. Excuse me for using the word cleavage, those of you who are sensitive to that sort of thing, but... give her a little cocktail dress, and the way it flows and everything's really nice. I'd like to have one. I'm just saying, for myself. You know, if you want to send me stuff, I don't know where you'd send it to. I don't have the P.O. box, but, you know, I'm just throwing that out there. Send it somewhere. I'll find it eventually. A little pink contrast. I really like yellow and pink together. It reminds me of Fluttershy. And make her a little evil Fluttershy. Wouldn't that be cute? But a little murderous Fluttershy be cute, and there's the dried blood on the side of her dress to sort of indicate that. Wouldn't that be that would just absolutely be wondrous. She's also kind of just jumping rope, you know, all innocent like the Freddy Krueger kids. 1, 2, Nifty's coming for you. 3, 4, she's looking through your door. 5, 6, jump rope around the neck. She kind of looking at Alistair's radio, sort of menacingly. It's gonna be very hard to choke him. He doesn't have a neck, thank God. Well, thank whoever you're supposed to thank in this universe. Speaking of radios, let's talk about Alistair. This one was a joy to work on, because Alistair is more or less the sort of unofficial mascot of the show, sort of thing. When people think of Has-Been, they think of Alistair. That's what I see online. So, this one was important to get right, so what I did is I took the hair of the Johnny Depp Willy Wonka and just plopped that on his head. Which, when I had that idea, was too funny not to go with. I'm sorry. And so from that, I just gave him this whole sort of 1940s... reindeer thing. Have you ever seen the colorized version of Miracle on 34th Street? You know what I'm talking about. This sort of limish, darker green tone that it has to, that the deers have to their bodies when they move in the sun. That's probably just an error from the coloring process, but it's still. That's where I got that idea. And so all the red is on the inside of his brown jacket, sort of giving the implying this sort of Cruella de Vil sort of idea of raw meat on the inside of something that he's skinned. He's wearing the guise of someone more friendly than he actually is. And also I gave him actual deer ears, because I will say it till the day I die, until I see it in the actual show when it gets made. Alistair's little foofy ears should have been articulated with his expressions. Back me up on this, come on. Right. Missed opportunities, Vivian, if you ever see this, which is unlikely, but if you do, I'm just saying, I know it's a lot of extra animation. I will gladly do it for you. Maybe not for free, but you know, I'll do it for you. One nice little touch is that I like is that I added a little knob bow tie. He's got that on there, you see that right in there, yes. Yes, that's his volume control in my head. So you can turn down his voice, or you can turn it all the way up, or turn it off entirely. Or maybe change the station and change his personality like Batty. Or maybe just whack his more antenna-like antlers that I gave him, that sort of square shape you see on a lot of retro TVs from this period. And yes, there was television in the 40s. They were gigantic boxes with these little screens smaller than an iPhone. Look them up. It's like putting an iPod inside of a refrigerator box. It's really awesome. if you're half blind, it's not awesome, but there we are. And so, one thing I've been doing throughout all of these is trying to replicate the now super popular striping pattern that Vivian Medrano uses to indicate shadow. You know what I mean? That very faint sort of big oval shape, and then the two smaller lines around it, or the one smaller line around it, very faint on there, which is very reminiscent of Japanese woodblock prints. So I started playing with that to sort of wiry effects. You can see that in Alistair's ears on this. There'll be links below where you can see the full version of this on my DeviantArt. The sort of pinstriping, the very silky satin pinstriping on there, which I see in a lot of really, really high-class suits from that period, had that sort of thing. So why wouldn't Alistair have that sort of thing, huh? 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 You say you couldn't afford it? Hmm? Of course he could afford it. He's Alistair. Look at him. You walk into a bank like that, of course they give him all the money. And call the cops. But you know they give him all the money. And Husk is a cat, because he is. Vaggy was a little bit of a tricky thing, because she's supposed to be a moth demon. I don't know how many of you know that, but that doesn't really come through unless you're told it, because then it's like, oh yeah, that's why the hair is that way. So I wanted to emphasize that just a bit. You have the two fanning bits of hair to indicate sort of the... I forget what the actual name of them is called, sort of antennae that moths have. They use those for communication, reproduction, that sort of thing. And her dress is based on a sort of showgirl sort of thing, but not the fringe. The fringe is actually more of a 60s thing, apparently, from what I looked up. It's more of a Vegas thing. It's supposed to be Los Angeles sort of formal wear that's kind of more risque than you would see in that time period, I'm just saying, but you know, creative liberties are being taken. This is not 100%. Because if we went 100% with the designs, everyone would look like Marilyn Monroe. So yeah, I kind of like this idea that she's sort of leaning forward on her hips and her back's sort of arching backwards, give her more of a articulated presence. You know, if that's a sentence. And I'm really proud of the shading that came out and the freckles that I gave her. And her expression is looking out off to the camera, right? Maybe she's noticing something off camera the rest of them aren't seeing. She's like, wait, what? What? And her little spear, I'm really proud of the little spear that I gave her. It's supposed to be like reminiscent of her missing eye that she has. Well, it is missing, but like maybe that's where her other eye is. Like maybe it got ripped out and it got turned into the spearhead and that sort of thing. And I'm just... You ever just stare at a piece of work you do and like, No, you have to talk about this, come on. So yeah, more of the striping going on, a little pinstriping. You make that layer of pinstriping and then you just lock it and just shade it accordingly. That having a very strong light source really helps to make things look shiny. Otherwise things just look like they're glowing all on their own and in a bad way. Something I found out the hard way doing this multiple times. And a little silk shawl. Has to be silk in this case, because moths, silk, that sort of thing. Have a counter on the screen maybe for every time I say that sort of thing. It depends on how lazy I am. Probably very. Charlie, I think I'm the most proud of in this redesign here. It's sort of a... And I can't remember what I use as a source for this. Sort of Danny from Cats Don't Dance. And Singing in the Rain references is what I use for the sleeves. And so this really is a bit more 1800s stereotype, the sleeves sort of thing. with, you know, the bands holding the shirt in place so that your arms don't move around like a bartender would have. So that's why they had those there, so that the sleeves wouldn't flap around and get caught on things. And I just love how the shading came out on her vest, which is I think I might have based it on one of the vendors, you know, the guys with the straw hats in BioShock Infinite. Yeah, that's probably where I got that concept in the back of my head. So this is sort of the most faux New York feel that I gave them. That's sort of, it's not exactly correct, but, you know, I just really like it. She feels like she stepped off a stage in New York somewhere. I love it, and I love the expression that I gave her, because in my mind, Charlie is, the way I thought she was going to be, and this is nothing against the pilot, but the way I thought she was going to be was just sort of amazingly unlucky. Like the reverse of Domino, but to everyone else around her. And she was totally oblivious to that. That's sort of what was my headcanon for Charlie before I saw the pilot. Like, Vaggie would have to clean up behind her. And all the bat, she would get shit on constantly without Charlie realizing it. But Vaggie doesn't want to say anything because she likes Charlie and Charlie likes her. And I thought that'd be a nice dynamic. It's sort of a Lucy and Ethel routine going on, but, you know, they could do something similar to that. I don't know. These are just my ideas. I'm not trying to put my ideas on them. No one put that in my mouth, even though you will. I just love the pants, the flaring out of the pants, sort of bell bottoms that are under control with those bands. You see the little flap button holder for her pants. That's kind of what they did before zippers came along. And I believe I got the button direction right, because on women's clothes, it's supposed to be the other way around. It's supposed to be, what is it supposed to be? It's supposed to be left side for women and right side for men. And since this is that time period, those rules stand. So I hope I got that right in me talking right now. I love the hairstyle, which, yes, is lifted directly from, what's her name? Damn it. The mom in Tailspin. Dang. What's her name? Becky. Yes, Becky. That's her name. I don't remember her last name. I have a memory. Be quiet. I do. Yes, it's lifted directly from there. And, you know, sort of tweaking it a little bit based on some references. And my references of my grandma. And I just really love the outfit that I gave her. And I really want it. You know, even though it would probably be hot as hell to wear. I will say that. All these clothes, except for the women's clothing, would be hot as hell to wear. I never understood what was up with that. Sorry, little gender tirade, sorry. Speaking of gender, Angel Dust, or in this case, maybe Angelica Duste. Oh, yes. I really love the flow I gave her. I just spit on my tablet. Oh my god, that's gonna make my drawings even harder. But yes, I really like the dress that I gave him. You know, made the bulges prominent only as needed. Because, you know, he's been through a lot and he deserves something. you know, that's the only reason. I wouldn't do that for any other reason. No, that's not at all. The collar... Oh my god, the necklace. I am so proud of how that came out and how shiny it is. Oh, I look at that. You know, I'm not trying to be narcissistic here, but I'm like, oh, I did something good! Oh, the little floofiness of her hair, and the flow, and the come around, and all that stuff. This one, I fully admit, this is just full-on Marilyn Monroe ripoff. And as well as, what's her name? Eve Arden. That's sort of vibe is what I was going for. That sort of aged yet beautiful sort of look. And not aged as in like actual age, but aged as in experience. That sort of thing. That sort of slightly shrewd, hardened look that's softened down by makeup and just the way they treat themselves. and just sort of fluffing and powdering. You see him powdering himself in the mirror right there in the compact. He has a lipstick pointing directly at the other lipstick, and a little leg coming off and around. That is pure showgirl right there, because that's what he is. He's a showgirl. Granted, it's for pornography, but it's showgirlness. And I just mentioned pornography, which will probably get me taken off of YouTube immediately. I don't know how the rules work anymore. But yeah, it's an absolutely beautiful dress that he's in. And, Cherry Bomb? Am I allowed to say that? Am I allowed to say the B word? You know what I mean? Because she is such a B word, if you know what I mean. Ha ha, ha ha, a B shell. I didn't mean anything else. The shines on her, I am so happy with. I mean, in her hair, the sort of, tank girl sort of a feeling to it. You know what I mean? The sort of complementary striping on the piping going around that's holding her hair, and sort of implies that her hair isn't really hair. It's more something she can just grab the back of her bun right there and pull it out, and it becomes the cherry bomb that she's holding, and she can break off the tips of the bombs and turn them into flares and throw and fire, and she throws it and just rockets off on its own, like the RPGs in Mass Effect? Yeah, the ones you throw in the air and they just rocket towards your opponent. I think it's Mass Effect. Correct me if I'm wrong. And so I just gave her that sort of a really basic yet destroyed dress and a showgirl's feather, because I believe her backstory is tied in close with Angel Dust, that she was a performer as well, or something like that. I don't know. The wiki is completely not canon, from what I've heard from Vivian's Twitter. But, yeah. Just gave her a basic bitch cocktail dress and made all of the direction focused around her head and her single eye, which is looking off towards Lilith, and sort of like, yeah, what are you gonna do, bitch? I got a bomb, bitch. What are you gonna do, huh? We're not even allowed to say that word on YouTube. Yeah, I'm saying it. I'm so edgy. Back off, I've had a bad day. My dress is on fire, damn it. I am so happy with Lilith. I said that again, but I am. Little reflections. You can see I just reflected it off of her chest and the flare down yonder, and trying to keep them nice and contained and logical. Maybe it's a really shiny bomb, that sort of thing. And it's just so pretty. And the coloring gets lighter on her skin as it goes up towards the light. You see her real skin color further down, about midway to her legs. And give her all these little freckles and more of the Viv striping. Which I don't know if it has a name. If it does, let me know. And how have we gone this long without talking about Lulu Boy? And I just realized I called him Lulu Boy. I'm going to get a visit tonight. This is my take on Lucifer, right here. Yeah. You know why he's dressed this way? Because this is apparently with the French, and apparently the Magni family that they're called, who rule hell in Hazbin Hotel, are supposed to be based on French designs. And for some reason, this was a popular kind of dress among the aristocracy in France in the 1940s. It's actually really nice. I forget what it's called, tweed. I think it's tweed. Material that's really, it feels really rough, and but it's soft at the same time. You know what I'm talking about? Everyone's dad had a jacket that was made of this stuff. You know exactly what I'm talking about if you grew up in the 80s. And so he gave it this sort of brown tones, these very earth tones that I saw in the reference photos. Because I'm not claiming this is 100%. This is my interpretation of the research that I did in the time that I had. So yeah, I gave him this very French bow tie and the hat and everything. It is kind of stereotypical French outfit. You know, we tend to think of the French stereotypes as being the banded shirt, but you know that there are other ones, because, you know, diversity in everything, including being offensive. Yeah, so the wrinkles in his folds of his shirt and his pants, I'm so proud of how they came out. Just the Viv striping working so well to emphasize the sort of crinkle crinkle and little zigzag motions in the bottom of the pants. And his little cane right there, which he needs. Also, I made him the shortest character except for Nifty, because that's sort of how I interpret him, is this really short guy. You wouldn't think of it. Like, he's standing on a stool in the canon portrait that they have in the show. Because it's one of those things, like, if you knew this guy was the ruler of hell, the single most powerful demon except maybe Satan, would you make fun of his height? I wouldn't make fun of his height. In fact, I'd sort of flaunt it. I'd be like, oh, you're going to say something? Go ahead. See the road right there? It's made of the last guy who said something. That sort of thing. And so his shoes, those are supposed to be penny loafers, but I just made them a bit more basic so they didn't distract from all the detail and the sort of fuzziness that I gave to imply that tweed fabric. Little experiment with there, and I love his expression, going for a sort of Joe Pesci look, you know, from Home Alone. Because don't you think that's how he'd talk, this design right here? Specifically, not the canon one, but this one. I mean, just look at him. Hey, I'm Lucifer. I rule hell. What are you going to do about it, huh? I know that's more of a De Niro thing that I just said, but you know, you can incorporate things, you know? That sort of thing. He keeps staring at me. You see, he's got this little ding wink in his little tooth wink thing from Home Alone, is why I put that in his teeth right there. Try to make him a bit more friendly and inviting, but at the same time, sort of like, you gonna fuck with me? Take my hand, see what happens. The Belladonna herself, Lilith, right here, beautiful, loving this dress so very much. The rendering came out so well, and the saturation, and especially in the hair, is where I think I did the best imitation of Viv's striping in the entirety of this piece. And I look at it and just like, yes, damn it, I actually did something. I did something good. You hear that, brain? You're not shit. Quit saying it, you are. One of those kinds of moments, and all the shines and the little strands on the side, and oh, it's so pretty. And the frilled dress, which is from what did I reference? Oh, yeah. Specifically Mexican dresses from the 1940s. And this was a sort of a popular thing in that area around there. Now, I'm not saying I did 100% research, but from what I saw, that was popular. There's sort of ruffle around one side of the shoulder, or both sides. Sort of, I cannot remember the name of it. It was not a quinceañera. Oh, God. Oh, my Spanish is leaving me. Oh, God, I lived in Ecuador for 5 years. Good God. But anyway, her expression, oh, I love it. I love what I did. Yes, I'm a narcissist. I admit it. I'm a narcissist, ladies and gentlemen. Look at that. That is a Rita Repulsa face if I've ever seen one. In fact, I might have been thinking of Rita Repulsa when I drew it. Sort of like, I can see Rita Repulsa's voice coming out of this. Although the canon Lilith, I imagine her voice sounding exactly like Barbra Streisand. You know what I mean? It's sort of like you know, Lucifer, love, demons. What you gonna do when love's involved? That sort of thing. Harley Quinnish, but serious. In the vid striping on the horns and so forth, referencing ibexes on that one to sort of get the dimensionality of it going around. And I think I pulled that off very, very well. And all the magnes have completely paper white skin, sort of fits, because I believe they're supposed to be based on dolls. And I just, I don't know what to say. Sometimes something comes out so well from how you. This is one of those times when it's exactly the way you saw it in your head is now sitting before you, represented in two dimensions, and it's like, yes, 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 moment for me. And I really, really love how the Viv striping on her dress, on the big part that's illuminated of her legs. Completely reflects the big fan. Is it like a shadow for the big fan of the frill on the shoulder, which was not planned, but you know what? It works, and we just have happy accidents around here, don't we, Bob? Yes, we do. Like he's here. Well, he's in all of us. But, yeah, overall, I think this is my favorite fan piece I've ever done for this franchise, and one of my best pieces overall. Yeah, altogether, I would love to see this. Well, maybe I could do that. I would love to see this be used, these designs be used in like an alternate reality version of Hazbin Hotel. For whatever reason, you know, maybe in a comic book, that sort of thing, like Crisis on Infinite Earths from DC. This could be one of the alternate universes they visit. Because I just want to see Kanan Alistair react to this Alistair, which I think would be funny as hell. Just looks him, Kanan Alistair just looks him up and down, rolls his eyes, and walks away without saying anything. I made a funny! And in 80s tradition, we've come to the end with that line. Thank you so much for watching this speed paint, me ramble for nearly 30 minutes, which is amazing. Thank you so much. If you have any questions or comments, please do not hesitate to put them in the comments. And, you know, where they belong. Where else could you do it? Because, of course, you put them there. If you liked what you saw, hit a like. And if you feel like it, hit that subscribe button. Don't think it's mandatory at all, but it would be really helpful if you did. And hit that bell. Because I will be making a comeback in the future as soon as I can get out of retail and into more creative endeavors. Because it's eating up all my time, my day job, paying for everything I need to live. Because, you know, that's kind of important. You know, my cats need food. Maybe I do too. We'll see about that. Thank you so much for watching, and you all have a very nice night.